Greetings, television viewers out there in TV land, and welcome.
I'm Mr. Elk.
And I'm Mr. Seal.
We're Mr. Elk and Mr. Seal. And we're excited to be here in Jamestown, New York, for the first annual Lucy Fest.
Mother would have loved to have been here this time, and I think had this festival been established, she would have tried to come back every year for it too.
Lucy, the name means laughter almost everywhere in the world, but now nowhere more than in the hometown of the Queen of Comedy. The Lucille Ball Festival of New Comedy is providing a stage for promising performers and writers who will make sure the laughter never stops and who could help a small community become a comedy capital.
I know she loved this town, and I know this town loves her. And in a way, tonight is a fitting tribute from Jamestown's heart to Lucy's smiling face. Lucy, this one's for you, hon. God bless you.
Jamestown, a close-knit community of 35,000 people in southwestern New York. The small city, located near Chautauqua Lake, is known for industrial craftsmanship, pioneering labor management cooperation, and being the birthplace of Supreme Court Justice Robert Jackson and renowned naturalist Roger Torrey Peterson. But go around the country and tell people you're from Jamestown, and they'll ask you, as they have me, isn't that where Lucy's from? Lucille Ball was born August 6, 1911, on Stewart Avenue in Jamestown. The young girl soon moved to Montana with her parents, but Desiree Hunt Ball returned home when her husband died. So Lucy grew up around her grandparents, Fred and Flora Bell Hunt of neighboring Celeron. This house, on what is now Lucy Lane, is still known as Lucille Ball's childhood home. Lucy quickly found friends who shared her early passion for performing.
When we were in the lower grades, we always play acted among ourselves in the village there. And we were sort of isolated up in our end of the town. There weren't too many other boys and girls there. So we would go down to the movies in Celeron.
Maybe entertaining came naturally to children who lived near the Celeron Amusement Park. Lucy soaked in the vaudeville and theater acts, and even sold hot dogs. Her acting drew attention almost immediately.
She would stop the show. She had so much talent, even at that early age.
At 15, Lucy left to find fame in New York City, but she would be home within a year. She was spirited, and fun in acting usually meant more than studying.
She's full of pep, and something like a tomboy. She could play sports and this and that.
Half the time we were just tearing around from one place to another after school and coming home.
Despite her local triumphs, Lucy was panned by a theater instructor in New York City who said she had no talent. Jamestown didn't agree, and a role in the Players Club production of Within the Law brought audiences the first glimpse of Lucy, the redhead.
Golden Glint is what was popular those days, and the Golden Glint shampoo, and all we were supposed to do is shampoo your hair, and it would color it, you know, and shampoo it. It turned out something terrible. It was just, well, it was orange, practically what she ends up with, orange, but those days, orange hair, who had orange hair, you know?
Marion and Lucille would remain lifelong friends and even live together when Lucy again went to New York. Lucy finally broke through as a cigarette model. By 1933, she had made her way into films, rising from slave girl to queen of the B-movie.
Okay, buddy, put her on a truck and I'll give you a lift to Baltimore.
Make it Washington? That's a deal.
Washington? Well, you're crazy. That's 50 miles out of my way.
Start pushing things.
Okay, lady. I'll sign. I met a lot of dames in my life, but I never met nobody like you, Knockwood.
Jamestown followed the success of its starlet, who, in 1940, caused a young Cuban bandleader named Desi Arnaz to faint in the film Too Many Girls. Lucille Ball was a celebrity at home, but who could have predicted what was to come? Lucy turned into a nationwide sensation, but she remembered to call home.
My maiden name was Lucille McGillicuddy, and I was born in Jamestown. Well, I'm positive.
McGillicuddy was a wacky name Lucy and Rose Malta clowned with when they were growing up. Lucille Ball had become one of the most famous and most loved women in America.
All the time, I thought that she was going to make good in her life because she was bound and determined to do something, and she did it.
Her dearest friends said stardom never changed the person.
No pretense of whatsoever. You took her, you liked her or you didn't. You know, it's just one of those things. That's the way she was. And I don't think she ever changed.
How could Jamestown honor a legend? Lucy and the mayor she spoke with disliked the custom of erecting a statue or renaming a bridge or a boulevard.
We wanted an ongoing living memorial that in some way recognized her talent and her contribution to the nation's well-being.
Jamestown Community College supplied part of the answer. State University trustees agreed to award an honorary fine arts degree to Dr. Lucille Ball. But just a month and a half before a May 1989 homecoming, Lucy suffered a heart attack.
When she was sick and she was in the hospital, really like the first group of things she said to me was, "Damn, there goes the Jamestown trip."
Jamestown sent huge get-well cards to Lucy and postponed the festivities planned for her first visit home in 33 years. She would come when she got better. But on April 26, 1989, the heart that filled so many other hearts with joy finally rested. The May homecoming show turned into a commemoration, conducted as if Lucy were present. Jamestown's living tribute to its great lady was revealed, a yearly festival of new comedy whose concept had been embraced by Lucy herself. To the executive director of the Arts Council of Chautauqua County, the challenge of staging the show was irresistible.
It's a magical mixture of a name that everybody knows and a thing that has value. I mean, I think that's magic. I think that's a hard combination to find.
The site for the gala? A grand vaudeville theater where a young Lucy had danced. Destined for demolition in the early 1980s, the old palace was saved. A community fund drive financed a magnificent restoration of the renamed Reg Lanet Civic Center. Now the theater waited for Lucy to come home. Showtime in downtown Jamestown. Memorial Day 1991 brings the joyous premiere of the first Lucille Ball Festival of New Comedy. Lucy Arnaz and her husband, Larry Luckinville, squeezed through the crowd and passed a convoy of cameras.
The greatest thing you can do for her and her love of comedy is to not memorialize solemnly what we had in the past, but with this, you are patronizing joyfully what we have now and what we'll have in the future.
You have a great thing to be proud of in this town, and it's not necessarily Lucille Ball, it's you.
Two local notables stopped merrily in a vat of grapes christened by Lucy. everyone knows what comes next. And then, more than 1,000 people, some with grape juice stains on their formal wear, stream into the Civic Center for the opening night show. They see Lucy Arnaz standing on the stage of a theater whose vaudeville acts inspired young Lucille Ball.
She knew about this, and she would have been so delighted at the turnout. We filled the house, huh?
The first night gala, hosted by New York City radio personality Elliot Forrest, serves up a Lucy Fest appetizer.
I'll do it with my other hand. Oh, it's gone. Hey.
My sister has the Imelda Marcos of nail polish, okay? She couldn't be here because she's home buffing. It's like...
That humor. Of the people. By the people. For the people. Shall not wear it from the earth.
I'm the only one that's stupid enough to do this next trick. It's the truth. It's the truth. There's a couple Russians and Chinese out there, but they don't have any choice.
And as the stars of the first ever Lucy Fest revel in applause that shakes the walls, the Jamestown High School Band rouses historic spirits in a venerable theater. Later, under the stars, Jamestown's Walk of Fame takes formative steps. Larry Luckinbill immerses his hands into wet concrete, a duty that delights his daughter, Kate. Actor Greg Mullavy, a Jamestown native, fears getting stuck. And Lucy Arnaz tries to make an imprint as permanent as the one her mother and father made in their final trip to Jamestown.
We're starting here in Jamestown, and this is the world premiere of Forever Darling, a picture produced by Desilu, released by MGM, and here is one of the two stars, Lucille Ball. Lucy, it's wonderful to have you here in Jamestown.
It's just the greatest thing that's ever happened to me in my whole life.
February 1956. Lucy and Desi convulse Jamestown when they choose the Palace for a Hollywood movie premiere. 10,000 people ignore dismal weather to cheer their arrival. Thousands more bring thunder to a downtown parade.
I had no idea that home meant so much and that home cared this much.
Well, I never seen anything like this in my life. I know that Lucy's has been so thrilled over it. She's been crying half of the time that she's been here.
Lucy and Desi are the king and queen of Jamestown during 2 days of nonstop appearances. The coronation comes on premiere night at the Pulsating Palace. Radio station WJTN records the spectacle.
The flash bulbs are popping. All of these hundreds of cameras here in the crowd taking pictures of Lucille Ball and Desi Arnaz.
The crowd laughs at Lucy the comedian.
You're going to
bomb me out in English.
Gladly. Of all this stupid, half-witted, imbecile, half-witted people.
Never mind. Go back to Spanish.
Never mind, I'll talk to you later.
A surprise chant from the balcony of the theater shows true love for Lucy, the girl from Jamestown, and Celeron.
There was a cheer of Celeron High School
cheer. Oh, no! Oh, God love you. Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, God, that did it. Now I'll never be able to talk or anything.
And then Lucille Ball makes a promise.
Someday I'm going to bring our children back here, and I'm going to show them. I I'm going to show them what it's like to come from a wonderful town. I'm going to see that we spend some time here so that they see some change of seasons.
I'm here now, and I'm thrilled to death, because I'm going to make use of every single living, breathing moment here, investigating and exploring and imagining what it must have been like for her to have grown up here in this place. It just won't be quite the same as having her right there by my side, remembering.
How do you capture the essence of an incomparable comic? LucyFest hoped to celebrate Lucille Ball's innovative spirit by supplying a stage and encouragement for comedy's next generation. To translate its vision into a show, the Arts Council for Chautauqua County and the Reg Lenate Civic Center turned to the New York City-based American Vaudeville Incorporated.
For American Vaudeville's point of view, it seems such a natural connection to us, because if you study Lucy's history, you see that it was in this very theater was where she was first inspired by seeing vaudeville shows that her grandfather took her to.
The playbill for the first year would consist of original short plays, performances by up-and-coming comedians at the Civic Center and in nightclubs, prize-winning short films, and, for Lucy devotees, a retrospective of some of her early movies.
Styles and sensibilities, we made an effort to really make a comprehensive approach as to what's out there in comedy today.
A call went out for Side-Splitting Laughs. As its centerpiece, LucyFest commissioned three new plays from respected comedy writers.
Inside the curtain, the dietitian examined the limp body carefully. Well, I asked impatiently.
She said.
She said emphatically. Can you be a little more specific? What caused her death?
Beat me, but I can tell you one thing.
What's that?
She didn't die of malnutrition.
I thought people weren't having sex anymore.
No, people are having sex. You and I aren't having sex anymore.
What is it, hon?
We shouldn't have started this.
The kissing?
The talking.
A nationwide competition found the new voices. Out of 350 scripts submitted, six were chosen for production.
No, this is wrong. Oh, Christ.
Yes, that's certainly amusing, Mr. Breck. But do you know the capital of Missouri?
Sometimes you bore me so much. I want to run screaming down the highway, naked, jabbing myself with hot needles, just to prove to myself that I am indeed alive. That I haven't drifted into some catatonic state resembling death, but without its rewards.
Let's all remember our key phrase and why we're here. Self-esteem.
Oh, I didn't know we had to bring something in.
Please, call me Toby. Will you go out with me? I don't mind your midriff.
I'm after my leg.
It's a very lovely leg.
I'm not ashamed. I saw my opportunity and I took it.
Most of the performing artists came to Jamestown from New York City, a reversal of Lucille Ball's route to fame. Some were attracted by the meaning of the festival. Others were simply happy to have stage time. Actors' air, which, around Broadway, is as precious as Midtown Manhattan real estate. Together, they told the story of what it is to perform, to make people laugh, to survive in show business until the big break, or at least a decent living, comes. It's a story that a young girl from Jamestown lived almost 60 years ago.
Our time is up.
Oh, sorry!
So did I always want to be an actor? I remember sitting in my father's Lazy Boy recliner watching television when I was about 11 or 12, and I remember looking at the television and thinking, I could do that.
And most of us have that feeling, but
yeah,
it's a
well,
more difficult.
Then I tried it out, and lo and behold, not only could I do it, I turned out to be good at it.
I think anybody that knows that they, that enjoys making people laugh and can make them laugh, discovers it before they get to out of short pants. And so I was doing that as a child.
I'd been working for AT&T, a real funny place to work.
And I'd always liked theater and acting and stuff, but I hadn't really thought of it as a profession. I just felt myself being drawn to it.
How did you know that? I asked coldly, and let the question hang like the gallows.
Sometimes comedy gets the short shrift. I mean, having a good time or seeming to have fun with it doesn't, it seems like, well, that can't be very good or can't be very serious.
I trained as an actor. Most actors train. The focus is on serious acting.
Fantastic.
I like to think that I'm creating a career as a comedian.
I get dizzy. I lose my balance. It's nothing.
I hesitate to think of myself as a comedy writer. I think of myself specifically as a playwright. I don't tend to think of comedy and drama as being that different. In both instances, you really have to be true to characters, and you really need some sort of conflict.
You can goof up a comic moment by taking a step at the wrong time, turning your head at the wrong time. It's like a science. And not get a laugh. It's that specific. In a dramatic piece, you have a little more leeway on, like, a dramatic moment.
How did you get involved with Lucille Ball?
About 11 years ago, I worked with David Munnell, who's the producer and a director of one of the plays. He came and saw me in a production that I just closed in New York on Broadway, and he came and saw me doing pratfalls for 2 hours and came up to me right after the show and asked if he could buy me dinner and said, listen, would you like to come out to lovely Jamestown, New York, work in a beautiful theater, stay on lovely Lake Chautauqua with a pleasant family, enjoy a nice community, and do physical comedy? I said, oh, yeah, I think so.
I am so grateful to be working. I'm grateful to be out of New York City. I'm grateful to be in Jamestown in May when the flowers are blooming. It's been very nice to be here.
It's really exciting to have things being seen for the first time and staged for the first time and screened for the first time. And I think it's very, very ambitious.
How have you adapted to having to learn 4 or 5 plays at a time as opposed to working?
It's been a real challenge. It's been a lot of fun.
I'm also a type E woman, meaning I try to be everything to everybody.
I'm doing 4 roles in 4 plays, very, very different. Physical comedy, heavy character, foreign character.
My job is pretty simple here. All I have to do is fly around the stage and be a space alien and run around the stage in next to nothing. So I've been going to the gym a lot while I've been here.
I know Lucy.
But you didn't even know me.
I know Lucy. I know Lucy.
All right, I believe you.
It's been a real different experience for me to feel appreciated and unique, because I live in a city where there are 40,000 actors and 90% of them are unemployed.
New York City has been very challenging. It's a lot of fun. I've done a lot of different kinds of things there. I've done a lot of cabaret work on my own because I'm also a singer and a songwriter. And so New York City, I think you can sort of say it's one of those places, it's what you make of it.
The role that I just created in Taking Steps, the role of Mr. Watson, was the best work I've done. It's certainly the best show I've done, biggest role I've had in a Broadway show.
I qualify as a regular working actress, you know.
It's a very low percentage of all.
It is a very low percentage. I mean, there's not too many in between. There's not much of a middle class in acting. There's the names and the stars that make a lot of money, and there's the starving, and then there's just a few of us that, you know, the journeymen. We're still there, and we're doing it.
We shouldn't be doing this. It's entirely your fault.
My fault?
What did you get?
This is a great dress, isn't it?
All of the time that I put in doing the theater that doesn't pay in these tiny little houses where you pretty much provide your own costumes and props and, you know, help move the set and everything else, then when I go do a commercial and I'm treated like royalty and paid very well, it just sort of balances things out a little bit.
At any moment that, you know, you could get something big, and that all changes. I mean, that's happened to a lot of people I know. They become the overnight success after 20 years.
You just have to believe in yourself and keep working.
Let me put this out.
Oh,
your parents wouldn't let you play with?
That's the whole joy of being a performer, is that you can see things from a slightly different angle.
I'm going to take this water, and
I basically do kind of offbeat comedy magic. I grew up in Southern California, and I had the opportunity of getting to know a number of wonderful old-time comedians and magicians, and they sort of took me under their wing and taught me a lot of their trade secrets.
Oh. When I nod my head, you hit it, okay?
There's so many comedy clubs around the country, and so many universities that have entertainment on them, and more than enough venues is basically what I'm saying, that I'm going to stick with it until no one needs a laugh anymore.
The character himself is sort of based on a teacher I had over at the school in Paris, who was a bit pedantic. I was an actor originally. I acted in repertory companies and did that kind of work. I'd always written comedy, and somewhere along the line I decided it was more fun to do comedy than to act. So it was easier for me to take comedy seriously than acting.
In New York, they would have, like, suicide. You couldn't see the falls in New York. They would have the suicide. They'd be, like, 100 feet high. There'd be barbed wire sticking down. And things would be electrified. And, of course, nobody would go see them, except the people who want the graffiti on the fall. They find a way to paint Niagara Falls in New York.
I tend to work in not so much comedy clubs, but the more small theater-type clubs where I can... I do my characters and I do monologues. Fortunately, my wife is very patient, so she has a job also, which is fortunate. And she's not a performer, she's a quote-unquote real job.
You can teach comedy to a certain point, and then the rest is music. It's got its own score, and it's just hearing and feeling the music.
What is the feeling inside when you do something that you think should get a laugh, or this should break them up, and all of a sudden you listen and there are crickets?
You go, ah! I stink! You do, you know, I mean, you learn the more you do it that every audience is different, and every audience will laugh at something different.
One, two, three.
First gig we had paid $450, and we thought, this is great. And it, like, never happened again. We've done a lot of stuff, but nothing for that amount of money for the amount of time.
Are we getting that much? Well, how much are you getting this?
For like 20 minutes worth of work is what I'm saying. Comedy clubs will pay one guy for one spot, and they'll pay two guys as if they were one guy. So that's our problem. Well, we're good enough to make it, but Rob eats too much, actually, for us to be able to afford to make a living at it.
So. We started off at the top, as Mr. Rock and Mr. Sale, at the top of the World Trade Center, the observation deck. That was our first gig.
That was our first gig, and it's been downhill ever since.
For the bill ye blee, for the bill ye blee, ye are Icky Sherlin, bum bum. Ye are Icky Sherlin, ye are captain, ye are captain, ye are captain.
I guess I'm an acrobat, which loosely defined is someone who tries to hurt themselves in creative ways for your entertainment and enlightenment. Equilibrist is another big term. I balance myself in weird positions.
Here we come, the world famous
valet of the latter.
I was a real clumsy kid. It's all a facade. Everything I do, it took me so long to get down. But now that I do, it's my job. I figured someone had to do it.
What I'm going to do is play you a little bit of music. That should be enough.
Back when I was with the circus, it would be like you'd call home and they'd ask where you were. And I remember one time I'd forgotten. I had no idea, and like the only person I could ask was a Bulgarian fella that just learned English like last week, and I asked him what town this is, and he said 4 o'clock, and...
It's worse.
Too happy about the career choice, but I don't, they're getting used to it.
Can't stop. I got it.
Hey there, Georgie Bush, do us all a favor, stay alive. If you can survive, you'll spare us all the terror we dread. Don't die, please, hey there, Georgie boy, if you die in office, we're all screwed. 'Cause you had the great foresight to choose someone so absurd. Give us your word. Don't die, Georgie Bush. He's just a heartbeat from the presidency.
Wanted anything that we specifically consider to be our focus, it would be social satire in all different forms, in sketch comedy and plays, and we'd like to branch out into some video work. We recently have been asked to become the resident theater company at Home for Contemporary Theater and Art in New York, which is like the best thing that's ever happened to us, because now we have a space that we can work out of on a regular basis. Because before we were just sort of this floating entity that didn't really have a place to perform.
Apparently the church is promising the woman full absolution for all her sins if she agrees to keep and baptize her child. The mother looks skeptical. The church is throwing in a free trip to Rome. And it looks like the Supreme Court is regaining its strength and pulling the woman into its corner. What a contest, sports fans. The woman is resisting, but the court is too powerful for her.
It's like sunblock 465. We'll be sitting on a beach. We won't even see each other's faces with big piles of goo. Mr. Johnson, when was the last time you saw him on a commuter plane into Jamestown?
I don't believe in a drug-free America, and I think we should all hoist our glasses and drink to that one. This is the first time in the history of the world that these two countries, that any countries, fought over two letters, an N or a Q. You had two IRAs at war over a consonant.
Oh, there's an accent right here.
There are a number of festivals that have kind of sprung up around the country, but this is, they're usually all one kind of thing, either all films or all original works or all kind of variety performers. It's the first one that really tries to tie in everything that has new comedy and, you know, as part of it. So it's great.
And listen to that crowd.
Lucille Ball's hometown adopts a daughter. Lucy Arnaz officially came to Jamestown for the first time to help the community celebrate its most famous native.
If it is her spirit and accomplishments that have inspired you to
perpetuate the spirit of new comedy through this annual festival, then I know for a fact that she's smiling down on all of you right now with a lot of pride in her heart. And speaking for my entire family, I want you to know that you've made us all very, very happy.
Lucy was joined by her husband, actor Larry Luckinbill, and by their daughter Kate, because Lucy Arnaz also had a personal journey to make, a private exploration of the town and times that gave the world the genius of Lucille Ball. At commencement ceremonies for Jamestown Community College, Lucy accepted the honorary Doctor of Fine Arts degree that her mother had been looking forward to accepting in 1989. College President Paul Behnke delivered a tribute.
We hold Lucille in our hearts because she practiced the ultimate art, comedy, with a talent that made reason out of chaos and sense out of the idiocies of our lives. I present Miss Lucy Arnaz, her daughter, with this diploma and hood from the State University of New York.
And Lucy Arnaz became the daughter of Dr. Lucille Ball.
I didn't know how I would feel as soon as I got up here. I have some prepared remarks, but I have to tell you off the top of my head, my mother would have been so thrilled. Now, let me get that out of the way. I am truly very excited to be here today on behalf of my mother. I'm thrilled just to be standing on the terra firma known as Jamestown, New York, after hearing about it for all these years. My mother talked about this place all the time.
Lucy revived some of those memories when she arrived at the little theater of Jamestown for a tribute to her mother. The community theater's predecessor was the Players Club, and two people who acted with young Lucille Ball in Within the Law were in the front row with Lucy Arnaz. The tribute included a recreation of one of Lucy's most loved scenes, the Vitamita Benjamin commercial, and a chronicle of Lucille Ball's life in song and dance by the Junior Gilders. And with Lucy Arnaz on stage, the renamed Lucille Ball Little Theater of Jamestown was formally dedicated. Lucy Arnaz offered advice to those who, like her mother, dream of not just reaching the stars, but becoming one.
Just find out what you do really well and just do it. And then you'll be you and we'll be proud of you too, and Jamestown will have more than one famous person or two to be proud of. You should be proud of coming from Jamestown, and not just because you came from Lucy's town. And I love you all. Thank you so much for this.
But Lucy Arnaz's 10-day visit was only partly about celebrating her mother's success. She wanted to find out where Lucille Ball really came from. In a way, where Lucy Arnaz comes from, too.
She never talked about it as a small city. She just talked about the lilacs and Lake Chautauqua, and coming back, we have to go back and see the leaves change if we can't get there in lilac time. You know, to her, being where the seasons happened was always a wonderful thing. Kid wouldn't want to grow up having that beautiful lake right in front of him and all that space to run in, you know, and your school is a block and a half away and your parents all live nearby. I think if you grow up with a carnival right in your backyard, you know, you have a tendency to get a theatrical experience. People who join these shows from all over the world, and they're fascinating people with fascinating stories and, you know, yarns to spin. And I think that had a lot to do with what influenced her, what inspired her to use her imagination the way she did. I think they're famous enough people that you deserve to know a little bit about just their ordinary everyday stuff. Stuff that might bore somebody else about just ordinary people, but they're not ordinary people, they're the famous people. There are people here who have been telling me for years, I wish people would ask me for the real story. I just want the color. I want them to go back and remember what it was like to be little. I said, don't even tell me about Lucy so much. Tell me about Jamestown. Tell me about Celeron. What's it like to grow up here?
We spent all day with her yesterday, and it's just, well, let's just do the stuff that you do with my mother.
Thank God these people are still around, because my children are going to have a wonderful history to pass on to
to our grandchildren and things. You know. Everybody I've talked to here, without fail, tells me that my mother was like a little like Puck in Midsummer's Night's Dream. That's the image I get of her, always trying to think of something fun to do, you know, trying to, and not in a nasty way, never like in a negative, harmful way to anybody, but people would, you know, they go, oh, the things your mother would do. I'm glad to know it, you know, it's like great, because with me, it was always, you know, now, what time are you coming in? You know how you get this impression of your parents that they never did anything? And they, because they want you to be so perfect. And it's so nice to know that that's not true, that we're all human and that they lived their life and did what they did. And God, I love knowing this. Why was she such a genius? It's up to God to decide how many of these magical people they want to put on the earth. You know, I'm surprised he doesn't put more. You give certain people the power to move other people in a direction. A lot of talented people out there, but only a few are given the power to really inspire. This sounds like a negative, and I don't mean it that way, but I've come to know in my 30-some years of existence that it almost is not possible to have it all. And if you really want to climb to the top of a profession, you have to focus very, very hard. And you have to want it really bad. And sometimes you can only want it that bad and block out everything else if you are in deep pain. Because whatever is in front seems like the cure for the pain. Maybe the cure was laughter for her. Maybe the cure was an enormous amount of attention. Maybe just the Mount Everest of attention was going to be what would finally make it all right for my mother. So in order to get the Mount Everest of attention, you have to be the best. I think that my mother deep inside was a very kind of pained person, and it took me my lifetime trying to figure out why. I don't think I ever did, but there's a driving force with someone that takes them to the top. And I'm going to be living in New York now, and this is established so that I can have a reason to come back every year. I want to see it through, and I intend to come up here a lot. I say that. Don't hold me to it every year because things happen, but that is my intention.
The festival has another celebrity to count on, Greg Mulavey, who grew up in Jamestown. The actor, who attended many Lucy Fest events, remembers talking with Lucille Ball about their hometown.
I had the great good fortune of appearing with her in one of her last television shows, Life with Lucy. And we talked again about Jamestown, and I talked to her about a little bit of part of this particular festival, the museum they were going to do in her honor, that was going to be part of this theater. Now it's become this.
We've seen an awful lot of talent. Equal to anything you're going to see on television or anything you're going to see in movies and on stage, in Broadway or anywhere else.
Mulavey remains close to his hometown. During Lucy Fest, he and fiancé June DeYoung stayed at the home of friends Dudley and Joni Erickson. He thinks the new comedy festival is important not only as a tribute to Lucy, but as a major event for the community.
Jamestown is to be commended and extolled for its incredible, you know, fortitude in pulling this off. I mean, against a lot of odds, in my judgment. And the town has just sparked it.
Will comedy lovers also find Lucy's home comfortable? From a model of the I Love Lucy set at City Hall to a special Lucille Ball exhibit downtown, Jamestown appealed to the many fans drawn to the festival by the magic of Lucy's name alone. A woman known as one of Lucy's biggest fans feels the tribute was true to spirit.
And I think this will, you know, generate more interest next year. More people will hear about it because of this initial one and the press that it is getting. And I think next year will be fantastic as well. I think the turnout will be incredible.
Hoskins, who is from Toronto, loaned a portion of her Lucy collection to the exhibit. It became a magnet for fans from distant cities.
My apartment in Brooklyn is decorated a la Lucille Ball. So I have a lot of memorabilia myself, posters and photographs and magazines and books.
I've loved Lucy since I've been, 1951, when she started on TV. I believe it was 51, wasn't it? I think I was about 10 years old. And I watched it with my mother. Mm-hmm. My mother enjoyed it, so her and I watched it together. And I've even got all the tapes. I sent away and got all the I Love Lucy tapes at home.
In Toronto, they're on at 11 o'clock every day on a particular station. You can see every episode ever made, I guess. They just play them over and over and over again. So. constantly being reintroduced to new generations all the time.
The character that she portrayed was so lovable, and you just enjoyed her, and it was simply funny, you know, and that drew you back to her every time. You knew you could tune in, she was going to be, you know, adorable, funny, make you laugh, and I think there was just a quality there that is hard to recapture again, and I think she holds something that, it for us, that no one will ever do again.
Lucy Fest organizers knew that no one and nothing could copy the one and only original.
The thing about Lucy is that she was funny. She was universal in her ability to appeal to people, but that's very hard to find. So we try to do a little bit of everything to hopefully have something for everybody.
For visitors and residents, Lucy Fest brought fun to Jamestown and unusual sights that delighted crowds. But it took a lot of energy. At the information center, the theater, and all across town, volunteers underpinned the production of the festival. 350 volunteers, or about one in every 100 people in Jamestown, had something to do with the big show. The coordinating director found the response inspiring.
The best volunteers that any community could ever have. I mean, these people are unbelievable.
The community adopted Lucy Fest performers who lived with families in private homes rather than in hotel rooms.
Volunteerism has been outstanding. You know, we're staying in private homes and people are driving us around, and it's beautiful. I'm right on the lake.
They've surrendered their bedrooms and their cars and their food to us.
Our family, the Halls, are staying out in a tent in the backyard, and we have the whole 22-room house to ourselves.
We're running up quite a phone bill, too, let me tell you.
Most of us who are involved with this Lucy Fest are from New York City, and we're going nuts because everybody's too nice up here.
To come here and be recognized on the street, or to have people say, you need this? We'll be glad to get it for you. In the city, it's more like, get out of my way!
That Lucy Fest offered a showcase for Jamestown as well as the performers was no laughing matter. Is there an economic value to laughter? Jamestown, like many communities, is trying to preserve its identity. Cities fight fiercely for quality jobs. A comedy festival is not as traditional as an engine plant, but a big event lures new money into a community and gives it a signature that the rest of the country recognizes.
I think it has the capacity to really put us on the map, both as a fun thing, as a fun thing. And it's something that has integrity.
The festival's debut focused national attention on Jamestown, which already knows the arts can be a powerful attraction. Nearby Chautauqua Institution is a world-renowned cultural center with a booming impact on the region's summer economy. The restoration of the Civic Center has already pointed downtown Jamestown in that direction. A consultant's report envisions an emerging theater entertainment district. It could go farther. Lucy Arnaz told a city agency she would support the creation of an ambitious Lucy Desi Center, a facility which a study suggests could draw 100,000 people a year.
It's going to be about their lives. It should be the Lucy Desi Museum, and let's learn about both of them and how he grew up over here and how she grew up over here, and look at how this weird thing, and oops, they almost missed, and oop, they missed, and then boom, look what happened. And we can learn about ourselves and a lot of things through both of their lives and how they dealt with what was given to them, you know.
A train station in the downtown district is the proposed site. Celeron, too, wants to remember the girl from Lucy Lane. Its lakefront park is being improved and will bear Lucy's name. The village's historical society reminds people that Lucy always talked about Celeron in the same breath as Jamestown.
She never forgot her Celeron High School friends.
Jamestown and Celeron have sought and received the approval of Lucy's family for their projects. For now, the Lucy Fest has other important supporters. Jamestown's Gebbie and Sheldon Foundations have pledged significant financial backing to see the event through its early years. And that is allowing organizers to think ahead about what could be.
The experience for somebody to come here and see this festival and see everything is going to probably be an eye-opening one. When most of us sit down and we watch situation comedy on television, here's a chance to see just what comedy can be that we wouldn't expect.
The first year offered a sampling, the 1992 festival, will reveal more.
Larry Luckinbill and myself and Lucy talked about doing a play next year. And we hope to contribute to the event by doing a one-act play. Hopefully that will occur. And there will be even bigger and better events next year.
Live radio shows, comedy workshops, full-length plays, a regular theatrical season, attendance by thousands of people. There are enough future possibilities for the Lucy Fest to allow Jamestown to establish a serious reputation as a comedy capital.
It's exciting that I'm in on the first season of something that eventually will be known nationally. It's exciting to be working with people who, with directors and producers who I want to see my talents and then hire me again, hire me again other places.
Lucy Arnaz says her mother would have loved it.
It's about laughter. It's about encouraging new writers, new comedy writers to do their stuff. It's always hard to find new good young comedy writers. And that's what she liked about it, you know, that it was an eternal kind of a thing, an ongoing thing. It wasn't something dead like a bridge.
Don't tell me it's Jamestown, New York, because Jamestown, New York is north, and it's the end of May, and it should be nice here. This is what it should be. This is what Virginia's like. And I think you should put a statue of Pocahontas in there and try to get that Virginian Commonwealth thing, because it's going to be probably, what is it? It's probably 40 down there now. This is really terrific weather if you're a gnat.
You can make the leap from upwardly mobile to wealthy before we're 45.
Oh. I've scheduled myself to become a millionaire before I'm 40.
Really? That doesn't give you much time.
I'm aware of that.
May I ask what your contingency plans are?
Well, I'm considering several options, including suicide in the event of not cheating my
An aggressive approach.
Your part's easy so far. Don't look at me like that, Dean.
Okay. So we got through the improv portion just fine. When we got to the set pieces, it's starting to fall apart.
Just as long as you kept there, like that.
Like what?
Like a pawn caught in my headlights.
Hang on, Louie, 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 hang on. Down, down on Broadway. I said, I can dig it, you can dig it, we can dig it, they can dig it, he can dig it, she can dig it, you can dig it. Down, 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 down on Broadway.
She has two single daughters. I'm the oldest, the one with the biological clock with the giant snooze alarm on it. Thank you.
Yeah.
A young girl left home and became a legend. She was very far away, but kept a sense of place. And when the time came, the woman left a special gift for the place where it all began.
As official chairperson for the first annual Lucille Ball Festival of New Comedy, I officially welcome you, and let the laughs begin.
To Jamestown, I'm driving north and headed homeward bound. Can't wait to see my friends and family. I'm coming home to you, my Jamestown. So glad I packed my bags and turned around. No place on earth I'd rather be. When the city traffic ran too loud and too fast, I would recall my quiet, happy past, spent in my friendly town where there was time for friends and family and peace of mind. So now I'm going back to Jamestown. I'm driving north and headed homeward bound. Can't wait to see my friends and family. I'm coming home to you, my Jamestown. So glad I packed my bags and turned around. No place on earth I'd rather be. No more busy city crowds, nor flashing to Jamestown. I'm driving north and headed homeward bound. Can't wait to see my friends and family. I'm coming home to you, my Jamestown. So glad I packed my bags and turned.